Let's go, Hornets fans. It's time to swarm as one. Let's go, Hornets fans. It's time to swarm as one.
Mike. Now it's pulling. What we talking about?
Thank you. Situation is in that
cover.
Yeah, it's the head.
First down.
drive done. Breaking tackles, got the first down inside the 35-yard line. Oh, my goodness. Once again, great second effort by the Hornets.
A lot of people were excited when they saw that Santo Dunn committed to Alabama State as a graduate transfer. That's one of those reasons why. He's just a shifty guy. He's able to get out of tackles with that small frame. But, you know, he's still pretty tough as well.
First and 10. This time Davis fakes the handoff. Can't get away from the tackler. Isaiah Land there for the tackle. It'll be a loss of 3 yards. It'll be second and 13 yards to go from the 37 of Florida A&M. Leading at 7-0. We've got 2:48 to play in the first half. And again, ASU is in no hurry.
I think Alabama State has the game right where it wants it. Even though they're behind right now, this game is exactly the way they want it. Low scoring, you know, only a few possessions. Now, they got to score, obviously. But this is the type of game that Alabama State wanted to have. Florida A&M wanted to have a track meet. That happening so far.
Throws it in the flat. Halfback pass wide open. Johnson, touchdown.
Yes,
37 yards. And ASU's an extra point away from tying it. I was a little worried, Kamari, that pass might have been forward, but it wasn't.
Oh, great job there. A great wrinkle by Harry Williams. We've seen this a couple of times this year where they've gone to that flea flicker. It seemed to work every time they've run it. And a beautiful throw there by Scott to Johnson. And a big play for Alabama State. And it gets the crowd into the game. The crowd's been kind of silent, kind of quiet a little bit. Now you get the crowd back into the ball game. And again, look at the time. 2:20 left in the first half. And it's going to be, hopefully, it's going to be tied at 7.
Extra point coming. And it is through. Good by, I believe that was Jaden. So just like that, 2 minutes, 20 seconds to go in the half, and we're knotted at 7. And I don't have the tail of the tape, but I had to be at least about a 6-minute drive. I want to say they got the ball with about
10 plays, 76 yards. Looking at about 6 minute drive there.
It was between 5 and 6 minutes, no doubt.
Just under 5 minutes on that drive. So again, Alabama State doing what they needed to do. You know, they finished the drive off. They got a little bit of help, but they were able to finish off that drive. Nice wrinkle there by Harry Williams, the offensive coordinator. And the key to it, they finished with a touchdown. And we've got 2:20 left, and the game is tied at 7. Exactly kind of a score that you want to see if you're an Alabama State fan. If you're Florida A&M, you want to see this thing go back and forth like a pinball. But if you're Alabama State, again, the defense started to settle in the game. Now you have the first touchdown. So now you feel like if you're an Alabama State fan, now the Hornets are into the game now.
So they'll kick off. Eichner is the place kicker on kickoffs. And he will kick here with the wind at his back. 7-7 after that long drive by the ASU Hornets, both in length of field and on the clock. That one's going to bounce right at the feet of the return man. I believe that is Davis. I'm sorry, it's Smith. No, they're going to say it's Shereed with the return. I'll get it right. Give me 3 or 4 chances. Let's see if we'll get the hurry up from the Rattlers with about 2 minutes to go, 2:14.
Rattlers will get the ball to start the third quarter, so it's important drive here for Alabama State's defense. Keep it tied at 7 and kind of make it a 30-minute game here now as we head towards the second half.
They've got one back. Also, the H-back is in, Jeremiah Pruitt, who comes in from time to time. That one's thrown over the middle and complete to Smith. He's right at the marker. They will stop the clock and move the chains. I'm sure ASU will give up the middle of the field. Florida A&M does have all three of their timeouts remaining.
Try to keep everything in front of you. Don't try to get too fancy here. Just try to keep everything in front of you. And don't give up any big plays. 10 yards, you know, not a huge play, but you don't want to get too many of those on this drive.
Pruitt split out to the left. Instead, Davis has it, and he's going to get about two, if that, still driving. Colton Adams is there along with Kelvin Stokes. We got a little problem going on out here.
Got a little extracurricular stuff going on. Guys getting involved there. Cunningham's coming off the field.
Did they throw a flag? I don't see one.
I saw one fly up. I think they just picked it up, but I remember seeing a flag. What I did see was DeMarcus Cunningham got a nice little chat there with his coaches. It was a one-sided chat, of course.
I believe Florida A&M may have called a timeout with a minute 33. So DeMarcus Cunningham.
So Carson Vinson for Florida A&M got called for. He was called for there in Sports Life for FAMU. So 1:33 left in the first half, Graham. I think, you know, like I said, you know, Alabama State, you know, coming in the game, we said, you know, would Florida A&M be able to throw the ball all over the place against this Alabama State secondary? Would Alabama State have to outscore Florida A&M to win? Well, a couple of things have happened. It started that way. It started to look like they were going to have to do that. But the defense finally settled in. And then Alabama State finally gets a drive to get into the end zone. And on a nice trick play, a nice little wrinkle there by Harry Williams Jr. And I think, you know, you catch Florida A&M a little bit over-aggressive, and they went over the top on them. Well, it took a couple of shots on that drive. You know, the first pass was a deep shot. So that kind of opened things up a little bit, I thought, for the Alabama State offense. So, again, you know, even though you may not hit those deep shots all the time, you got to take them because, you know, sometimes, you know, if you just think you're going to go 5-6 yards here or there against a defense like Florida A&M, it's going to be difficult.
Well, I take a shot here. Second and 8. After the timeout, let's see what they come up with. One back set for Mosa. He's looking to his right, throws it complete, and that should be enough for a first down for Xavier Smith. Well, is it? No, it's not. They say it's a yard short.
Again, Mosa's having too much time to throw the football, though. I mean, he's able to stand back there and just pick this defense apart. Just find your spot.
This time they'll run it and get the first down. Davis to the 44 of ASU. They'll stop the clock to move the chains. Clock now at a minute. Florida A&M still with two timeouts remaining.
Florida A&M feels like it's in good shape right now. Near midfield, two timeouts left, plenty of time.
Well, they are in no hurry, are they? 50 seconds before he snaps. Here comes the rush. They pick it up. Now here comes more rush, and Musa throws it away again. And here's a flag. They're going to call it, I believe, on ASU.
Well,
somebody kicked the football as it went incomplete. And I'm not sure who that was. It might have been Varner who did it.
Again, this is the type of thing Alabama State has got involved in these situations before. We saw it a little bit against Jackson State. You know, you don't want to put yourself in position. You don't want to give the offense any kind of momentum. And you know, Alabama State, you got to know that at some point the opposition, because they're a little bit frustrated, you know, they expect to come in here and probably have about 20, 24 points at this point. Well, they're a little frustrated right now, so they're going to try to get any kind of edge they can, and you cannot get involved in those type of things. I think that's one of the things that Coach Robinson is going to continue to talk about at the halftime break. Hey, guys, we're in the football game. Don't give them any more help than they need. They're already a good offense as it is. They don't need any help.
It's called delay of game, which means it's only a 5-yard step off, and the down does count.
Right.
So now second and 5 at the 49. Musa looking. Looking, now moves to his right. Still looking, nobody is open, throws it away. Here comes a flag. I'm going to guess that's holding.
Yes.
It came from the head referee. And I would assume that Eddie Robinson is going to take this penalty. Because right now it's the clock that's the main issue for Florida A&M, and now they've got another second and long coming up. This time it'll be from about the 42-yard line. 41-yard line, let's make it. It'll be second down still. Clock down to 32 seconds.
Like you were saying, not a lot of sense of urgency from the Florida A&M offense. I thought they were going to come out here and start, going a little hurry up, but you know, they kind of, did the kind of normal offense. You know, nobody huddles anymore, really. But, they waiting on that sideline call. But, again, a lot of time had taken off with two timeouts. I thought Florida A&M would have tried something different.
And another flag. And they had a new quarterback in that time. And this is going to be a delay of game. They had Ja'Cory Jordan. Well, now they're going to say A&M got a timeout before the flag. That was Ja'Cory Jordan, a redshirt freshman out of Jacksonville that had lined up at quarterback. I didn't see if Musa got hurt. I don't think he did.
I think it was probably just trying to cross Alabama State up there a little bit with the new quarterback. But
well, it didn't work.
No, it did.
Because it crossed up the A&M
Alabama
offense.
Alabama State, in that regard, they were very disciplined there. We got both bands getting ready for the Mighty Marching Hornets and, of course, the Marching 100. Probably, we did have the Sonic Boom in the South here early with Jackson State, but probably the most anticipated battle of the bands coming up at halftime that you'll get to enjoy there between those two outstanding bands here in Montgomery. But, again, like I said, on this drive, Florida A&M, they might be kicking themselves a little bit. They don't come up with points on this drive. They're going to be saying, man, we had about a minute and 30 left. We had the ball in pretty decent field position.
Yeah.
And we really didn't take advantage of it.
Well,
this drive left.
The kickoff came with about 2 minutes and 20 seconds left in the first half, and they're down to 32 seconds now. They're certainly capable of making a big play. They've done that a couple of times. Now Moose's back. Plenty of time. Throws it complete. That is Smith. He's got a first down. They're going to stop the clock with 23 seconds. They'll move the chains to the 42-yard line. Still not in good field position as far as a field goal is concerned.
But again, he had time to throw the football. And Smith already, I got him down with six catches. I'm going to look at the last stats here in just a second. Six catches, 73 yards. We don't get to him. It's going to be a long day.
They will throw one complete and then out of bounds. That is the H-back, Jeremiah Pruitt, with a catch. He'll stop the clock with 13 seconds left. I'm guessing they need another 10 or 15 yards to even have a shot. Ball at the 37 of ASU, tied at 7. Last minute of this first half. Davis is in the backfield. Musa to throw over the middle. And it's dropped.
Wow.
Oh, wow. You'll take it. That's the tight end, Young, who dropped it. That would have put him in field goal range. And now 8 seconds left. You have pretty much one play. Yeah, let's say two plays because you've got a timeout.
That's one of those things where, Alabama State, they dodged a major bullet there because those Florida A&M receivers are usually sure-handed. And they had a drop right there. And I think that's the first drop of the game. These receivers are really, really good at catching the football and protecting it as well.
Davis with Musa. You got Manigo out there. And they will hand off to Davis. He's going to try to get out of bounds, and he does. He has the first down, but more importantly, did he get it in field goal range for Jose Romo Martinez? This is going to be about a 48-yard kick after they spot the ball. I'm assuming they're going to kick it.
I missed one earlier from 46, I think. So, they're going to try it.
Yep, it'll be a 48-yard try. Long for Martinez is 47 yards. He's already missed one today. Again, not a lot of wind, but enough. A left-footed kicker, and now we've got a timeout by ASU. The old ice the kicker. Which today is a good day to try because it's getting chillier by the minute.
Very much so. You can really ice the kicker here today. far as Alabama State, I think right now you got to be feeling pretty good about your position right now. The way that you started the game, not so great. But, again, it's a 60-minute game, and you can see the defense had to settle down a little bit. And once they did that, it allowed the Alabama State offense to finally get some confidence as they were moving the ball down the field. They were finally able to score a touchdown there late in this first half. So I think whether or not this young man makes this field goal or not, you got to feel good if you're Alabama State about the position you're in. Florida A&M will get the ball to start the third quarter, but the way that the defense is playing right now, I think you got to feel good about your position if you're Alabama State.
So here it comes, a 48-yard attempt by Martinez. It's a good snap. The kick, I believe it went right again, no good. And that's how the first half's going to end. Alabama State has given up a few yards in this first half, but they find a way to tie it here with their last possession, and they lead it, they are tied 7-7. With Florida A&M as we go to the locker room. Just a couple of numbers there from you as we get ready for these two great bands.
Oh, yes. I'll say this and get out of the way. Florida A&M right now, total yards 185 to 153 in favor of them. Passing yards 151 for Florida A&M, 102 for Alabama State, so they're kind of holding their own there. The rushing total, 17 carries for 51 yards for Alabama State, 17 carries for 34 yards for Florida A&M. And, of course, the leaders here for Alabama State as far as rushing. Ja'Cory Merritt has 31 rushing yards. Of course, and then you've got Demetrius Davis, 6-for-9, 65 yards right now. And, of course, receiving. Keyshawn Johnson, three receptions for 55 yards and a touchdown. So, good first half for Alabama State, and a good first half for the Alabama State defense as things start to settle in there late in the first half.
All right, we're going to step aside for the bands that will be playing. Both bands are here today, and we will come back for the start of the second half. Again, 7-7, our score here at halftime. Hope you enjoy the bands here at ASU Stadium.
Thank you. Shelby Chipman. From the year 2010, an Atlanta legend, the College Park songbird herself, Monica, the tune, Everything.
Your Alabama State University Mighty Marching Boys!
will be joining me again here in just a moment. Getting ready to start the second half here from ASU Stadium. Both bands performing here. The Marching 100 for FAMU. Of course, the Mighty Marching Hornets and the Honeybees finishing it off as they always do with a fantastic routine there at the end. Game is tied at 7 as we get ready to start this third quarter. I'm Kamari Darrington. Here comes Graham Dunn here in just a moment. Florida A&M, the advantage in total yards, 185 to 153. Jeremy Musa, 13 for 22 for 151 yards and a touchdown early on. So here comes Nathaniel Eichner to kick it off. And we're underway here in the second half. And on the run, it's going to be taken at the 11-yard line by Shareed. And Shareed makes a spin move across the 30. Watch out. He gets all the way out to the 39-yard, out near the 40-yard line. And that's where Florida A&M will start the first possession of the second half as Shareed made a spin move and was able to get it out to the 40-yard line. So good field position for Florida A&M to start this second half. Jeremy Lusa, 13 for 22 for 151 yards and a touchdown. He was sacked twice. A.J. Davis, 10 carries for 32 yards as the Florida A&M running game really got off to a great start. Again, it's a running game that has not been very successful. They don't run the ball a whole lot, just averaging 100 yards per game, but they're able to pick up a couple of the first downs. And now Jeremy Musa will hand it off to Terrell Jennings, and Jennings will take it out to the 43-yard line.
And I apologize for my absence.
That's all right.
But some things, can't be taken care of,
yes, sir,
unless you know what I mean. All right. Second and 7 after the carry by Terrell Jennings.
I was just mentioning how good Florida A&M's running game. They kind of started to open things up for them a little bit. Of course, Musa 13 for 22 in that first half, so they would love to keep him going. And that's, let me see a pass to Shareed.
Right on cue, right? Back shoulder pass complete. It is Shareed with a catch and a big first down for Florida A&M. I think we may see a little bit more throwing in the second half from them. They toyed around with the running game a little bit, had a little bit of success. They're up to the line of scrimmage quickly, and right out of my mouth I say they're not going to run it much, and they do. They don't get anything, but keeping ASU a little bit more honest. No gain on the play. That was Jennings.
We've seen plenty of times already today, Ram. These Florida A&M receivers are getting open. And right now, this is similar to how the first drive started in the first half. So we'll see if Alabama State can make the adjustment.
They'll throw one over the middle, almost complete and almost intercepted. Three defenders back there. And then you had another receiver kind of cutting across.
Second receiver,
which was
Manigo.
I'm still not sure on his name. I apologize. We'll say Manigo. We'll keep it that.
Yeah. It makes it easier.
So it's 3rd and 10. 7-7 our score. First possession of the second half for either team. They got triples to the right. That was kind of a delayed snap, and Musa just throws the ball into the ground. They're going to call it an incomplete pass, and it is. But it should be grounding.
Well, it should be grounding, but there was another flag before that. They're going to call offsides against Alabama State, so that might just.
So it's going to wipe it out. Yeah. It doesn't matter. You're right. I did not see the flag. I apologize for that. So it will be saving grace for Musa. But again, if it was grounding, that should be offsetting. Or did they blow it dead beforehand?
Well,
I don't know.
They didn't blow it dead until Golden Annas picked up the ball. So I'm not sure how they.
Did you hear a whistle?
I didn't hear a whistle until Golden Annas picked the ball. But a big third down here already for Alabama State's defense.
A&M working against a slight breeze about 10, 15 miles an hour at gusts at times. One man in motion is Shareed. And they'll throw it to him in the flat, complete, and he's got a first down inside the 20.
Another missed tackle, although Shareed had a little bit to do with that. And a nice move to the outside, and Just couldn't make that tackle. So you can see early on in the second half, they're already using Shareed. Shareed had a nice kick return that you missed on the cram. About a 30-yard punt return, kick return out of the 40-yard line to get, kind of get jumpstart this thing going for Florida A&M.
From the 19, first and 10. Three wideouts near side. Musa looking, backing up, throwing, almost picked off. Checking to see who got a hand on it.
Trey Phillips.
It is Trey Phillips. Trey Phillips had a good game so far.
Yeah, had a big hit early on special teams and a nice job over the middle there. And again, they've been going over the middle a lot. That's really where they've been making those plays against this Alabama State secondary. So, like we said, halftime adjustments, Alabama State's been making them. They're only allowing 9 points a game in the second half this year. So they did a really good job against Bethune-Cookman last week. Slowed that offense down, so we'll see if that is similar here in this game.
Second and 10. Jennings with a huge hole. Close to the 10. He'll get to the 12. That's not supposed to be happening. This is not a good rushing football team. But they've had a couple of holes here. And now they got third and about three. They rush up to the line of scrimmage. This time Musa having to move out of the pocket and throws it away. That was intended for Darian Oxendye. So fourth and three, what do you do here?
He missed two field goals, so I think you go for it right here. You're going to A&M. And, this is a big play in this football game.
This can be very big, yeah.
It could be very big here. Alabama State gets the stop. They can at least get the football back and try to move this offense. So big play here.
One back set. Fakes the handoff, rushes on, Musa gets rid of it, and it's intercepted in the end zone. And brought out by, is that zero? I believe it's Urshad Davis. Let me check.
I think that's Chauncey Moore, number 11.
Is that 11? Okay. Well, I knew it wasn't Colton Adams.
No,
I saw a one, but I thought maybe I'm seeing a one instead of a zero. So it is Chauncey Moore with the interception. I believe that's his first of the year. There are penalty markers.
Celebration here for just a moment. The offense is coming out on the field.
Well, maybe there's not any penalty markers. It was another flag. It was another towel.
Yeah, that towel, man. They are,
all right, I'm saying it right now. Yellow flag should be illegal. I know those are ASU players that have them, but they're not good for those of us in this business. So they do get the stop. First and 10 from the 8 for Alabama State. Their first possession of the second half. Davis runs into a lineman, and that's going to cost him. He's going to go down. 31 is over there. They're going to credit him with a sack. That is Isaiah Land.
Land came in the season one of the most decorated defensive players in the SWAC. He's kind of had some issues early on in the season with eligibility and the whole thing that happened with Florida A&M earlier this year kind of dropped the stock a little bit, but he's still a very good football player and still going to be very sought after in the NFL draft later on. So still a very good player.
Loss of, let's see, 5 on the play. Second and 15. From his end zone. Davis, handoff. Trying to bounce outside. Here comes a flag. Merritt with a ball carry. I have a feeling this might be holding, and they'll probably decline it because it'll only be about a 2-yard penalty. And he only got he lost it a yard. Actually, it's an illegal shift. And that will be declined. So third and about 15.
Well, the main thing here is to not throw an interception or turn the ball over. Main thing here is you want this ball to hit the turf or hit a receiver's hands, but you don't want to turn the ball over right here.
Ball is at the 2. Davis still waiting for the snap. He will throw it. They're looking deep. And Johnson knocked away. Almost intercepted. But you know what? That might not have been a bad idea because it's just like a punt. Courtney Cox out there defending.
You almost hope that he would have caught that. I mean, it would have been a turnover, but like you're saying, it would have been more or less a punt. now you're punting from your own end zone. So, you know, again, it was one of those situations where, you know, Alabama State, that they had the ball deep in their own territory, just had to try to make something out of it, and they couldn't. But the more important thing is they took care of the football. And here on this punt, it's going to be very important that they get the punt away, they get the punt out, and, you know, what Ames do to get field position. But we saw how Alabama State's defense has been playing as of late. So, you know, we'll see what happens here.
Just don't step backwards if you're Aubrey Grace.
Absolutely not.
They got everybody up on the line of scrimmage, just Florida A&M. High snap. This time they will not come after it. The ball's going to bounce at the 37 and stopped right there. So Florida A&M will have great field position. Second time of the second half. With 10:08 to go, and they're kind of right back where they started, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, this is a football game that, you know, Alabama State, you know, we talked about them wanting to keep this a low-scoring game, wanting to get it late into the fourth quarter, probably put some pressure on Florida A&M. A&M's moved the ball pretty well. They're over 250 yards in total offense, but they haven't really been able to generate when they get towards the red zone. When they get inside the 20-yard line, Alabama State's been able to, you know, shore things up. So, Again, it's going to be incumbent on Alabama State. A short field now. Let's see if Alabama State can hold.
From the 38, first down. Davis is back in at running back. Shahid is split to the right, and we got a flag, and apparently somebody moved early. It's going to go against Florida A&M. So they're going to start this drive now behind the sticks. I'm assuming it's against Florida A&M. They're acting like it is. Back to the 43 it goes. It'll be first and 15. Good crowd on hand today. It's chilly. We've put on our jackets here in the press box. Still a one-back set for Mosa. And Davis bounces it outside, gets a nice block, and he's going to get about 12 yards to the 31.
Like Varner on that opposite side looked like he was being held by one of the Florida A&M offensive linemen, but Davis able to get to the outside, turn the corner around Varner, and pick up a few more yards, about four or five Hornets chasing him. So, again, this running game, a little bit of a surprise for Florida A&M today. And, you know, it's kind of sparked their offense at times.
From the 31, second and about three. We're under 10 minutes to play here in the third quarter, tied at seven. Mosa now in the I set, and he's going to take a timeout. Doesn't like the setup. So it comes with 9:15 to play. We'll see how this plays out. You want to keep your timeouts as long as you can in the second half. Want to take a moment to thank our veterans for their service. This, of course, is Veterans Weekend. We're having Military Appreciation Day here at the stadium. We had some members of the service out on the field for coin toss. So a very special weekend, and again, we couldn't be here without you, quite frankly.
Absolutely, and I want to give a shout out to my dad. Served 20 years in the Army as a nurse and an instructor. Got up every morning, 4 o'clock, went to a post. Kept food on our table, and I appreciate him every day for it. Taught me a lot of life lessons. And, just a great man, you know, all together. In the Army. Met a lot of great people there, lifelong friends he has, and so shout out to my dad for his service to our country, for his 20 years.
Second down, fake handoff. Mosa throws it right side and caught, and that'll be enough for a first down. I thought they might get a push off by the receiver, but no flag.
Man, Xavier Smith again. He is just—he's a weapon. He's coming up on 100 yards again. He he's coming up 1,000 yards of the season. He's been able to get open several times. That time, we had good coverage on him. The Smith made that little move, kind of tugged Jersey a little bit, the subtle things that as a veteran you can get away with. When you're a freshman or sophomore, you don't get away with those things.
So it's first and goal right at the 10-yard line. Adams coming. They pick him up. Throw is in the flat. Oh, knocked away nicely.
Beautiful.
I believe that's 16 with the play. Mikey Victor.
And that was big. He had a Superman for that one. But
he did.
It was a huge play for him. He was that tall, big frame to get out there and to knock that pass down because they had picked up the blitz very well. They've actually done a pretty decent job against the blitz at times. Alabama State has been able to get back there. Moose has had to throw the ball away at times. But, you know, picking up the blitz is key for Moose because it gives him those few extra seconds he needs to get off those passes.
Let's see if they try to go inside this time. Here comes Colton again. He's got the tackle in the backfield. Colton Adams. He hadn't called his name much today. Called it early, but we call it there as he brings down the running back Davis for about a 4-yard loss. That'll make it third and goal at the, we'll call it the 13.
Well, Tompkins native, I mean, the young man just loves to play football, and he's a football player. I mean, when he steps out there, you can tell he was built to tackle people and make big plays, and he did that once again. On his way to 100 tackles and moving himself up the record books on a single season here at Alabama State with tackles. I mean, he already had 88 coming into the game, so just an amazing, amazing football player and a good young man as well. And good to see him playing because he's had some injury issues over the years.
And now we got a flag, or do we have a timeout? They're going to have to use their second timeout on this drive. That could loom in the fourth quarter if this is a close game. So it's 7:55, Florida A&M. That's 7:55 in the third quarter. Florida A&M has one timeout left.
We talked about before the game. Florida A&M, you know, since that loss to Jackson State, they hadn't been in these type of games. You know, Southern, to some degree, last week was close down the stretch. And of course, they played South Carolina State down to the end. But for the most part, this seven-game winning streak, they won by, you know, 10, 15 points. Now you're in a tight ball game against a team that is trying to make that next step. You know, Florida, you know, yeah, Jackson State, Florida A&M right there, right underneath them. And then you got this Alabama State team where, you know, it's Eddie Robinson's first year. You know, he needed a signature win. I thought he got one a little bit against Howard when they beat Howard. Definitely when they beat Alabama A&M. They've been in these situations before. Florida A&M hasn't been in these situations very often. So, you know, experience in that situation certainly favors Alabama State.
Well, I ask you the question, and I can't remember if it was on the air or not, but have they been in close games? We know ASU has. Third and goal at the 13-yard line. You better find Smith, and he is on this near side.
Almost jumped off side.
Here comes the rush. Gaddy throws it, and it intercepted again at the 1-yard line, but we'll take it.
Oh, wow.
Unbelievable catch by Cale Jackson.
Cale Jackson coming through. Tried to go to the pylon, and Jackson just stepped in front, and I don't know if they hit the ground. They're probably going to have to take a look at it, but. Oh, what a big-time play by Jackson.
Well, I had binoculars on him, and he caught the ball.
Beautifully
as,
done.
As in binoculars, not the monocular kind. So it'll be first and 10, but here they are one more time down there with the fanny on their goal line.
And, again, the defense coming through when they need a play inside the red zone. They come up with it again. The secondary, very, very solid. And, again, I call it the times the no-fly zone. Well, we've already got two interceptions of Musa today. That was a big play in this football game on that big third and long.
I believe that was the second interception of the year for Cale Jackson. First and 10 at the 1 of Alabama State. Davis going to take it himself. He gets out of the end zone, but not by much. He'll pick up a yard.
That's tough sledding there running the football. Just trying to push the pile a little bit, maybe get some extra yards to give yourself some room to operate. But you know, right now, Alabama State, they're playing on this end of the field for a little more, almost the entire third quarter. So Alabama State got to try to find a way to flip the field here.
Well, they've done it before. We were in the same situation against Alabama A&M. Got a couple of big plays to get out of a hole. They will throw it here. Davis deep in his end zone. Steps out and now throws it side to the sideline. That may be. Well, let's see. I don't know if he was out of the tackle box or not.
I don't think so. I think.
And the other question is, did it get past the line of scrimmage?
Well, it looked like it went sideways.
There comes the flag.
There it is.
Yeah. I think that's the right call. That ball never left the end zone. So that's a safety. And that will give A&M the lead.
Like I said, you know, those are the type of plays you don't want to make. You know, you're deep in your own territory. You know, if it's not there, just throw the ball away. And, you know, that's one of those situations where Davis has held the ball a little bit too long, trying to make a play at the end zone. Sometimes it's better to just take an incomplete pass and go on to the next down. So let's see how they respond. And, again, it's going to be up to the defense to make another play. Now, Florida A&M, 9 points with 7 minutes and 4 seconds. I don't think they expected that. And, again, for Alabama State, you know, that's a mistake you can't have in a football game, but it's just a young man trying to make a play. Sometimes you just have to take what you can get. And that's unfortunate. He just couldn't get enough on that football to try to get past the line of scrimmage. I mean, a guy past the line of scrimmage, maybe you don't throw the flag right there. But I think the fact that where he was at on the field, I think you have to throw that flag in that situation.
So ASU will kick it from their own 20-yard line. It's like they're going to put a tee down. So Eichner will kick. Well, you figured you sit down there in your own end zone. I think they've run, what, 6 plays inside the 5-yard line. You can't move it out of there. And let's face it, I mean, ASU offensively has done what they've needed to do these last few games. But you're asking a lot for an offense that has struggled moving the football for much of the season. And there it paid off for Florida A&M as now they lead it 9-7. The deep men for Florida A&M are right around the 20-yard line. This kick will be with the wind. And it is fairly deep down to the 20-yard line. And good running room for Cherie, but here comes a flag. It's coming back.
Flags on his 30-yard kick return to start the second half. That time, though, almost every official threw a flag that time.
Probably going to be an illegal block. And if it is marked off from where the flags are located, this will be a 10-yard penalty. And they'll start their drive right around the 24-yard line. We got 6:57 left of the third quarter. 7-7. There are a few folks around the league are looking at that score saying, let me back up. It's 9-7, but it's still,
right. Right.
They're saying,
Yeah, you know, and again, every time Alabama State plays in a game, you always say, well, this is the best defense that this team has played. Well, Florida A&M certainly feels it will save Jackson State early on in the year. But really, this Alabama State defense, a lot of times, they play above and beyond what you expect of them, and they hold their opponents lower than what you expect of them. I don't think any Florida A&M fan here expected to have just 9 points with under 7 minutes to go in the third. But here we are in a tight game in Alabama State's wheelhouse.
They have run it a lot here in this game, and they've done that right there as – that is McLeod, and he is up to midfield. Oh, my goodness. Got a 27-yard gain into ASU territory. I haven't looked it up, but what has been their best rushing game so far? Well, this one may be it now.
This might be it. I think that we're getting there right now, if we're not already there.
Musa screen to the receiver, and that's good for about 8 yards. Now they're going to mark him down at the 43-yard line. That is Smith again. So it'll be about a 6-yard gain.
It brings him over 100 yards on the day receiving. So not a lot times you give up 100 yards receiving, but today that is the case.
Second and four. Ball at the ASU 43-yard line. Here we go again. Fakes the handoff this time. Out in the flat, complete, and Smith's got plenty of running room and a touchdown saving tackle by ASU. Mikey Victor keeps him from scoring, but not before a big gain and a big first down for Florida A&M at the 27.
And you can see why Smith is so dangerous. I said he was the most dangerous player on this team because he can do stuff like that. He can make guys miss. He can get them out in space. Usually doesn't get taken down one tackle there, but Victor did a nice job of getting to him. But again, you can see this Florida A&M offense, you know, getting some momentum after that safety there by Davis with the intentional grounding. A couple of great plays on this drive for Florida A&M. And sending one of the FAMU linemen out. I think they said his helmet came off.
Now they'll wind the clock. First and 10 at the 27. One back set for Musa. It is McLeod. He'll roll to his right. Looking, throwing, incomplete. Just got rid of it.
I would go to the football, throw it away.
Moose was probably proud of his former team today. Vanderbilt broke their, I didn't look it up, but I think it's about a 24-25 game losing streak in the Southeastern Conference.
Oh, good for them.
Upset Kentucky. And I believe that was in Lexington, if I'm
not
mistaken.
It was in Lexington. Kentucky kind of swooned there after that good start to their season. Going back to being what Kentucky was just a few years ago.
Yeah, I don't want to go there.
Mark Stoops doing a great job there in Lexington.
But they did start basketball season this week, so
true.
They don't care.
That's true.
Good play on the interior that time. As DeMarcus Cunningham comes in and makes a stop on McLeod. That'll be a loss of a yard. And once again, it's third and long. Now, early on, that was a big deal for Florida A&M. They converted. They have not done that as much here, which is part of the reason why it's just a 9-7 game. They got to get to the, well, let's say the 17-yard line. Maybe in four-down territory, depending on the wind. Musa again to his right. Gets a little pressure, throws it in the flat. It's caught, but not for much. That is Smith, and I believe that's Ershad Davis that made the tackle.
Good stop by ASU, though. They were able to.
And they are going to kick it from the 33, so that'll make a 43-yard kick against the wind again, although right now not much wind blowing. So Martinez has missed a couple already. This one is missed again. It's off to the right.
And you know, that's got to play in your mind if you're Willie Simmons late in the game. If it comes down to a decision like that, now you miss three field goals in the game. Do I send the kicker out there or not? You're trying to show confidence in your kicker, but if you go 0-3, I don't know what you do.
Well, he came into this game. He'd only missed two all year. He was 13 of 15. So not a good day for the field goal kicker for Florida A&M. I don't know if you trade 2 points for getting the ball out of your own end zone, out of the shadow of the end zone, but I think we'll take it. First and 10 now at the 26. Feel a little bit more comfortable. Davis in the flat, complete. They thought about throwing it again. This time it ain't going to work. Johnson pulled down, and he's going to lose about 6 yards.
Play worked once. It's probably not going to work again.
They yeah.
Had that well scattered right there. Tried to cross them up, but that play was going nowhere.
Back to the 19-yard line. They lose 7 on the play, second and 17. I spoke too soon about the shadow of your end zone. They're right back there. Not quite as close, but Davis will throw. Here comes the rush. He gets it to Johnson, middle of the field. He'll get that 7 yards back up to the 26. So a third and 10. Right at 26-yard line.
Kind of time last week, we saw Davis kind of get some good things going in the passing game. There's a big third down right here, but, you know, Alabama State, you know, they got to start making big plays here. They're going to get back into this football game. Down by two right now.
Now to get to the 36. Draw play, done. But A&M's ready for it. They were ready for that. As Dunn gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. So a punting situation for Alabama State. We've got 2:25 left to play in the quarter.
Well, now you got a chance to get, you know, get the ball relatively deep in Florida A&M territory now. If Grace puts up a good punt, he's had that early 54-yard punt that went in the end zone to end up being 34 yards. So see if he can get a good 45, 50-yard punt right here.
See what Grace can do. He can drop the ball. Oh, my goodness.
Lord.
And he's going to get tackled at the 10-yard line.
Goodness,
there was not a thing wrong with that snap. He just took his eye off of it. I don't know if a rush was coming on to cause it. It's not a turnover, but it might as well be. First and goal coming up for Florida A&M at the ASU 10.
It feels like it, though, doesn't it? It
does.
It's a turnover. My goodness, Grace, just lack of concentration right there. And for a veteran like Grace, that didn't even happen. You know, he goes out there about three, four, five times a game. So that was that's a tough play there for the young man. But hey, certainly one important weapon for Alabama State special teams. But that play at that time, you just gotta secure the football.
Now, I'm not saying this was it, but you know, you got the win at your back. You're thinking, man, just one. This is going to be my last time to punt it with the win at my back. And I think he might have been thinking a little bit too much. One man in motion for Musa on first and goal. They lead at 9-7. He drops back, throws, hit as he is, and it's intercepted in the end zone. Oh, wow! Another interception, and I think that's Jackson again. His second of the game, his third of the season.
Well, I tell you what, this Alabama State secondary is coming up big. Cale Jackson, you know, early in the season, kind of looked at as a backup, but didn't get a lot of playing time. But now you can see the maturation process of the season under his belt. And he comes up with another big play. Came flying out of nowhere. I don't think Moose even saw him, but it comes up with a big play. And that's the third interception of Moose of the day.
I watched it on the replay, and that was triple coverage he threw into. That was a bad pass. Give credit to Jackson for making him pay for it. Well, here we go again. First and 10 at the 12. Let's see if they can move it out of their own. Well, I'm not even going to say territory. I'm just going to get it past the 30. They will run it on first down and get about 5 yards. That's a positive. Done with the carry.
So right now, I think you're Alabama State. You're looking at the clock. You're saying, okay, we got about 16 minutes left, and we're in the football game. And so now this is a chance with this drive. They get down and score a touchdown. That really puts pressure on Florida A&M now. Now you're looking at a game where Florida A&M is a little bit tight. So see how they can finish this drive.
Hand off again. Dunn, though, very little. He'll fight back to the line of scrimmage, maybe.
He was still fighting there at the end of that play. He ended up getting up a yard on that one. It looked like it was going to be about 2 or 3 yard loss. And that's the thing with Dunn. He's so explosive in the middle. He's tough to bring down. They list him at 5'6". That might be generous, but he has the ability to just still fight for yards, even with his small frame.
Third and let's call it 4. And what do we got? Somebody's hurt. I think they're hurt. They're not running off the field like they're hurt.
What's going on?
What in the world was that? Now the player's coming back on the field.
Yeah, I think everybody's confused at this point. They don't know what's going on.
I don't know what that was about.
Maybe
in the meantime, Alabama State's going to trade out centers. I think Tarian Stafford's still dealing with an injury.
Yeah, I think so too. They're looking at his right hand once again. Of course, that's the hand he snaps with. So certainly want to make sure that that hand is okay.
And so Penn is back in. Yeah. The freshman from Wellington, Florida. Conversion down here, third and about four.
Look for Hickson and Johnson over the middle.
And I think that Penn flinched.
Yeah, it did. Well,
yeah, he.
You don't play a whole lot, and you're thrown out there. You know, you throw out there, and the spike kid gets a snap. We get this third down, and you know, I think he's a little nervous right now. But right now, no time for that. You got to play. Your number's called. You got to be ready to play.
As a former center, I feel for it.
Yes. It's rough on that. It's rough on that offensive line.
So now third and nine. Stafford is back in there.
I think you can still use the middle of the field right here, but one name showing blitz, they might want to get this ball quickly out of his hand.
They're bringing seven. Here it comes. Davis escapes, looking, and he's just going to have to eat it. He's going to lose a yard.
None of the receivers came to the near side. Everybody went the other way. And Davis has had nobody to throw the football to.
That's how the third quarter's going to end. A quarter that was played in the Alabama State end of the football pretty much the whole time. But only 2 points scored by Florida A&M. So they'll walk the length of the field for this, what we hope will be a punt this time.
Exactly.
By Aubrey Grace.
Quick numbers here. Florida A&M now up to 308 yards of total offense in the game. In that third quarter, that's 44 rushing yards, 79 passing yards for a total of 123 in that quarter. Meanwhile, for Alabama State in that third quarter, ooh, it's looking bad. Minus 16 now. Now, of course, part of that was Aubrey Grace's fumble there.
Yeah.
But just minus 23 rushing yards. Just one for two for 7 yards in that third quarter, and of course, just a rough third quarter there for Alabama State. Overall, for Alabama State right now, 137 total yards. So again, the running game, not where we needed to be. Just 28 yards rushing on 27 attempts. That's not a good average there. You had almost the same number of rushing attempts.
Well, and I'll make this point, and let's not undermine. Florida A&M's not a bad defense.
I agree.
They're fifth in the league in total defense. They only give up about 142 yards rushing. So they have a competent defense. The problem is that ASU's helped them with bad snaps, and yet here they are only down two because the field position has been so poor. And now they got to punt against the wind here.
Maybe we'd like to have that
from their end zone.
We'd like to have that wind there at the end of that third quarter for this punt, but see if Grace get the snap first and then get off a good punt here.
He got it. He's kicked it away. It's really not bad in this wind. It comes down to the 47. Shamir will get to the 40, and that's where the Rattlers will have it, first and 10 to start this fourth quarter. As I say that about the wind, it starts to pick up.
Yeah. And I just think, for this Alabama State defense, at some point they might have to think about scoring. I mean, the way things have gone so far for them, I mean, it's tough. They've caused three turnovers, so the turnover battle is slightly in favor for Alabama State. They just don't have any points off those turnovers. And that's the sad part about when you get those turnovers and you don't take advantage of them. It kind of deflates your defense a little bit.
And here's the other thing that doesn't make any sense, and that's the running the football that the Rattlers are doing. They pick up 5 yards there on the McLeod carry.
83 yards now total rushing for Florida A&M. So that's a great sign for the Rattlers. They're running the ball like that. Their offense can really stand out now passing the football.
They get three more there. It'll be third and two at the Hornets' 32-yard line. It is a two-point game.
And I think Willie Simmons is thinking this is four-down territory. I got a kicker that's 0-for-3 around from the same spot every time. I think I got to think about two plays here with this first down.
They send Musa out wide. They're going to snap it directly to the running back, McLeod. He'll take it to his left. He's bottled up. He's close, and I think he's got it. He'll get to the 29-yard line, and they'll move the chains. Well, you're thinking again, you know, and ASU has done everything. Their defense has done everything they've been asked to do in the second half. They have yet to give up a point, despite playing the entire second half backed up to their own end zone.
That's a frustrating thing when you're watching this defense. They work so hard to get the offense the ball, and the offense just hasn't always been able to take advantage.
They're going to run it again. McLeod runs over a defender and gets to the 24-yard line. It'll be second and, let's call it, about five.
Jam McCluster had the was the man that got ran over that time, but McCluster coming in, a decent linebacker that time, though. McLeod over the shoulder and was able to fall forward for some extra yards.
From the 24. This time Musa will throw it. Lobs one to the end zone and incomplete. No flag. Good defense again. Ershad Davis out there defending.
Again, just battling with best on best right there. You got Davis, preseason all SWAC selection. Xavier Smith, probably the best receiver in the SWAC. Two great football players going at it. That time, Ershad Davis wins the battle.
So we got a third at about five. Of course, a field goal, if you try it and make it, it's still a one-score game here in this fourth quarter. 12:34 to play. Jennings is in the backfield now with Musa. Smith in motion. And that's the way that Musa looks. They're going to try the same play again, and it's knocked away again. Knocked away again by Mr. Davis, fourth down.
I tell you, you put your best defensive player on Xavier Smith. He asked him, make back-to-back plays for us. He does it. It's fourth down. I got to think they're going to go for this because, again, the field goal kicker struggled. He's missed three today. And he's looking over there. And they're going to go for this here. This is a monumental. This is an important play here. I mean, they're all important when you don't have a stretch like this. But you just had to feel that this will give Alabama State a lot of momentum. They can get this fourth down stop.
Jennings with Musa. Again, they send one man in motion. This time, a Sharid looking, throwing at this pylon. He is short. He did not get there, I don't think. He got to the 20. He needed the 19.
They're going to certainly measure it, but
I don't think he got it.
I agree with you. They're marking it where they say mark it. He didn't get it.
That's going to be first down Alabama State. I'm a little surprised that they're bringing the ball. Well, maybe I'm not. They are not going to worry about it. They're saying Hornet football, and the defense does it again.
Boy,
oh, my goodness.
I'll tell you what. If Alabama State doesn't win this game, the defense is still getting the steak dinner from the offense because they're right now. They've done an outstanding job. And Keenan Isaac, again, the secondary coming up with another big play. Davis back-to-back plays. Now on the other side, Keenan Isaac against their two best receivers. That little Sharid that time, Xavier Smith down here on the opposite side. Outstanding job by this secondary. Well, I'll tell you what, Alabama State's defense is doing yeoman's work against Florida. They got a lot of yards, but just 7 points given up by the defense.
First and 10 at the 20. Handoff. Merritt caught in the backfield again. I got to give this A&M credit.
Boy,
their defense has come to play today.
The defensive line has just been solid all game.
That was actually the linebacker that made that tackle, but you're right. Loss of one. Second and 11. They've even tried a couple of trick plays. They've tried a halfback pass, a wide receiver pass, a Kamari Darrington pass. They've tried it all. Nothing. That's how they got their touchdown.
Exactly.
But nothing else has really worked. See what they do here. Plenty of time on the clock, 11:45 to go. Creech is in motion. Davis, here comes the rush. Screen. Merritt sidesteps. First down. First one of the half. Well, I say that. They're going to mark him. That should still be a first down at the 30.
Yeah.
But you'll take it.
Good play. They overzoot to the near side. They throw the screen back to the opposite side. And Merritt gets just enough speed to get to that first down. Just enough.
And last week, when they started moving the football in the second half, he was the guy they started throwing the football to. Let's see if they continue. Instead, they'll hand it to him. And he got grabbed by a face mask. I don't see a flag. He'll get a yard. Major again. He leads his team in tackles. He adds one to the total there. Second and let's call it eight.
68 coming into the game. So a guy coming up from a secondary spot that makes 68 tackles. Usually not a good sign, but that's a good football player right there.
Really is. Creech is the H-back. Merritt lined up with Davis. He'll look to throw again. Chase just has to get rid of it. That time he does do it the right way. He got rid of the football. As there were white jerseys coming on him fast. So now a third and eight. You're not going to win the ball game here. Just don't hurt yourself.
Yeah, you know, just like in when they went down here in the end zone, you don't want to throw an interception or unfortunately, they have this. Now, Florida A&M got the safety.
Yeah.
Right now, the important thing is to take care of the ball. We love to get this first down, but the important thing is to take care of the football.
I think that Florida A&M needs a map to get to their end of the 50. Third and eight. They hadn't seen it in a while, I know that. Davis looking deep, nowhere to go. Cannot escape the tackle of Dre Jones. So that'll be a sack and a loss of about 8 yards.
You admire his athleticism. You admire his wanting to stand in there, and you see kind of hobble a little bit. Uh-oh.
Davis just took a seat.
Yeah. You want to see him as he progresses in his career. You want to see him make those decisions just a little bit quicker. If you're going to run, go ahead and get out of the pocket and run. And then if you don't see anything, just throw the ball away. Those are little timing things that he's going to learn as he gets going. Because, you know, he hasn't played a whole lot in the last couple of years. And you know, he's played a few games this year. But those are the kind of things as you get older, you start to get that clock in your head. You know, and I'm sure as he progressed in his high school career, he had that clock in his head. You know, sometimes the game kind of speeds up a little bit for you. You got to put that clock in your head and say, hey, I only got a couple of seconds to make this decision. Right? Let me go ahead and run this football. Or let me go ahead and throw this football away and give us a better chance. You don't want to take unnecessary sacks in these situations here every day. But that's something he's going to continue to learn as he gets better and better.
Here comes a punt. Grace, this time against the wind. Moderate pressure, and that one's a knuckleball that's going to drop at the 40-yard line. That's about an 18-yard punt, and I don't think it was necessarily the wind. I just think he missed it.
Yeah, I think it looked like a miss hit there for Grace. So Grace with a fumble earlier, and now kind of a strength punt. So a rough second half for Arby Grace. But, again, like you're saying, we've been playing on Alabama State side of the field. It's like an arena football almost, the 50-yard war. Here in the second half, because you know, Florida A&M, we just have not seen even the shadow of Florida A&M end zone in the second half. So, but again, look at the game. It's bad.
It's a 2-point game.
It's a 2-point game with 9 minutes left to go. So,
but how much more can this ASU defense do?
Well, we're gonna find out.
We're about to find out. A&M ran a player onto the field, and I believe it was their 11th player. Jamarie Sherid now lines up. He literally ran across the field to set up.
I think now you got to give Alabama State a chance to sub now.
That's correct.
There you go.
And so they do.
Bringing Davis out, though, on this play. So.
Well, now they've got Jeffrey Scott out there. And they run it. And for the first time, I think, today, A&M's going to lose yardage on a running play. I know that's not true, but it feels like it.
Well, good job by McCluster. That time he went up the field a little bit. It forced Jennings to go out a little bit wider, and then Varner cleaned it up. Good job there by that linebacker.
Loss of a couple, second and 12. We're not quite to the point where you start watching the clock. We've got a little over 9 minutes to go. But you have to get the ball back here if you're Alabama State. You can't give up too many first downs. We do not know the situation with Davis, the quarterback for ASU. He may come back, he may not. Second and 12. Musa, handoff. It's like they're going to play the clock a little bit. They're saying, hey, their offense can't move it on us.
Yeah, you know, that's kind of what I think what Willis Simmons is. They're saying, you know, I got a kicker. He hasn't played well, but you know what? My defense is standing up. And so right now he's looking at that clock. He's saying, you know, it's third and long right now, but he's saying, you know, my percentages are better playing it this way than trying to stay aggressive, because when we have been aggressive, Alabama State has come up with big plays.
ASU brings Grant Gaddy and Ogletree off, and they bring Stokes and Jamal Brown in on this third and 11 from the 43. They got to get to the 32 for a first down. Musa will throw. Here comes pressure. And almost a sack and possibly almost a penalty.
Yeah, I thought that, and that's why I said, ooh, because I thought he had his hand up around his face mask. Maybe got the side of the helmet there. So a break there for Alabama State. But again, unless this punt goes into the end zone, Alabama State is going to have the ball deep in his own territory. I don't expect this punter, unless he didn't get the scouting report, that punters are done in this situation.
I'm sure Chris Fadul would love a high punt here. Done by himself. He's standing around the 9-yard line. They go after it, and they block it. It's picked up at the 45, 30, 20, 10, 5, touchdown. Hornets, Cale Jackson again. Oh, my goodness. I don't know who blocked the punt, but Jackson will get the touchdown.
Who cares who blocked the punt? Let the stats guys worry about that. Cale Jackson comes up with a big play. And, again, the third time he's had the football in his hands, this time he gets it into the end zone. Hey, we'll take it out. We can get it right now. A huge play in this football game, and a great job once again. Special teams coming through the second straight week.
All right, I'm calling Nick Saban here about whether or not they should go for two. It's 13-9. That's a four-point game. I think they're going to kick it to make it a five-point advantage.
Well, I think if the defense wasn't playing as good as they have, I think you do go for two.
Maybe so.
But I think with the way that the defense is playing and the momentum that they have right now, I see no problem kicking the football right here.
What a play. I'm going to let you check the stats and see who got credit for the block.
Find out here in a second.
That kick is up, and I think he got it. He did, barely, inside that right upright. What a turnaround, huh?
Well, I tell you what.
The defense scores again. 7:46 to go, and ASU has the lead, 14-9.
But again, the defense came through. They made the plays that they needed to, and then it just took a spark. And again, we talked about Alabama State having blocked three field goals already this year. This time they get a punt block, and then Cale Jackson picks it up. And they're going to give Tyree Saunders, back of a wide receiver, credit for the block. And then Cale Jackson, a 50-yard return. So a 50-yard return for Cale Jackson to take the lead. So Cale Jackson, two interceptions, a punt return for a touchdown. Might have a SWAC player of the week for the third straight week for Alabama State. Now, the Alabama State defense, once again, they kept chipping away. And finally, they make a big play. The special teams, they make a big play. Last week was Santo Dunn. This week was Tyree Saunders and Cale Jackson. Guys, unsung heroes, guys that you may not expect to make plays in games like this. Cale Jackson, a backup corner. We got Tyree Saunders, one of the backup wide receivers. But they come up and make a big play for the Alabama State team.
One thing that we didn't talk about much and really hadn't had a reason to, but since special teams suddenly has become a huge part of Alabama State's success, you know, they had that onside kick last week. right after they had scored the go-ahead touchdown, the Dunn return. And it was executed perfectly by Eichner. I don't think you'll see that here. He'll pooch it, though, to about the 20-yard line, 25-yard line. Good haul for the return man. I thought I saw number 11, B.J. Bowler, I believe, with a return. It'll be first down right there. And all of a sudden, the Rattlers, who were trying to run some clock on their last possession, they need points.
And that's kind of why in this situation, Wilson was looking at it like, they're not moving the football. But now you put yourself in a situation where now you have to get back to being aggressive. So now Alabama State has a chance to pin their ears back, go after Musa, and try to make one more big play. Still half of the quarter left to go. And Alabama State, they got to the fourth quarter. Now they've taken the lead. Let's see if they can finish.
First time that Florida A&M has been behind today. And it comes here with 7.5 to play in the game. They're going to run it again. And they're going to pick up good yardage again. McLeod gets a first down, 11 yards on that carry.
Now they do have one 100-yard game. A.J. Davis had it earlier this year at 106. I think they said it was.
Well, that's half of what he's gotten all season.
Right. So, that was the one big game they got. But Florida A&M, 105 yards rushing after that last run. So a big day running the football for Florida A&M.
They got to score a touchdown to take the lead. There's another run by McLeod. We're about four.
Looks like they're going to ride McLeod here. McLeod looks like he's the hot hand. Davis had a pretty decent first half, but it looks like McLeod is going to be the man of the hour here in the second half.
There he goes again. Another short gain. Victor with a tackle. Third and let's call it five. 6:43 and counting to go in this one. Hornets have jumped out ahead 14-9. They've got this game right where they wanted it. A&M came in averaging about 34 points a game. Hornet fans on their feet. Third and about six. Musa looking over the middle. That slant pattern works that time.
That man again, Davis just couldn't get there in time, and Smith, another big play for the senior.
Like they know if they pull it out of their pocket, it's gonna spend, right?
Exactly.
First and 10 now at the 34. Rattlers get up to the line of scrimmage, although they don't seem to be in too terrible a hurry as we tick under 6 minutes to play. This time Musa looking, throwing it deep. Uh-oh. He's got his man, and that's a touchdown. Is that Shareed?
Shareed that time.
Yep.
Yeah, we talked about Shareed, and, they're coming back. Hold on.
We got a flag.
It's going to come back, it looks like.
I missed something. You want to tell me what just happened?
I have no idea. They say it was incomplete.
Did he drop the football?
Did he drop it? He may have dropped it.
He must have.
He had to.
I got
to
get some new binoculars. I thought he caught it.
I thought he caught it, too.
Second and 10 into the flat, complete. Smith didn't drop that one. He'll get a first down. I apologize, people. I thought he caught it and carried it into the end zone. Nobody was celebrating. That should have been a clue.
Yeah, the funny thing is we didn't see Alabama State. We didn't see Alabama State celebrating either, as if he had dropped it. So I don't. Wow, what a play!
Well, in the meantime, bad news for A&M. They've got a player down. I think it's Smith, over on their sideline.
Oh boy, man.
I don't know. Surely not cramps. It's real cool this afternoon. That was a first down play, by the way, to the 23-yard line.
Looking through these notes here, I'd like to see when last time Alabama State gave up a 145-yard receiver. Smith, 13 catches for 145 yards today.
I thought his 100 yards last week was pretty special. Little did I know. All right, first and 10. It is Smith being tended to on the sideline. Clock moving, 5:15 to play. 14-9 ASU. Three wideouts to this near side, one to the left. Musa throws it. Again, going to the sideline. That's intercepted, but out of bounds. Double teamed on Sharid there. When your best player, number one, goes out of the game, you can do that. And we've got an injured player for Alabama State now.
I think Victor is the one that's down.
Yeah, I believe you're right.
Last play.
He's had a heck of a game.
Yes. Victor's come in and has really given Alabama State some good minutes. Made some nice plays. Again, the secondary, just so hard to get big plays on. Although today, Smith has been getting open a lot. Sharid, on that last one, he ended up dropping it, though. But, you know, again, just the secondary. This defense as a whole has just played outstanding today after that first drive. And after that first drive, they haven't given up a single point since that first drive that Florida A&M took 90 yards down the field. That they have a lot of yards, a lot of total yards. But so the stats is going to, wow, they had, you know, 400 yards of total offense. But, again, keeping them out of the end zone, that's the key. You know, a lot of defenses now, it's not about, you know, holding them to 250 yards, because the way these offenses run now, you're going to expect them to get their yards. But the key is keeping them out of the end zone, keeping them out of score position. And they missed three field goals as well. So Florida A&M has helped them out in that respect.
Like, Victor is okay. He's running off on his own power. So it'll be a second and 10 when we come back.
But again, field goal doesn't
I hate help. To ask this question, though. What is Alabama State's offense? They had, at the end of the third quarter, they had a total of 153 yards. And I don't think it's much more than that.
I don't think it's been much better than that. Let's see. Well, they only have 4 yards in this quarter, so
So they're not up to 160 yet.
No, they're not.
But right now the defense is getting it done. Second and 10.
141 to be exact, just to let you know.
Wind picking up here at ASU Stadium. Musa looking to his left, got a man complete. Missed tackle, but the second one not.
Jabba Isaac, he was able to hold up Sharid just enough from a cluster to make the play. But again, we're down to 4:45. This is a huge play. Again, another big third down. It's third and short, so let's see how Alabama State handles it. Florida A&M has a lot of different ways they can take this.
Smith back on the field. He's lined up in the slot on the left side. Here comes the throw from Musa. It is caught. And trying to keep him out of the end zone, but he can't do it. Touchdown, Sharid. And the Rattlers are back on top.
You know, you can only ask them to cover these guys for so long. Sharid dropped that last one, but he comes up big with that play. And Hornets down now by one. So, you know, Victor struggled there a little bit, tried to get it, but now it looks like Florida A&M is going to go for two. But listen, you know, still plenty of time left in this game. Even though offense hasn't done a whole lot today, you know, now they'll have a chance with 4 minutes left to go. They were able to do it against Alabama A&M late in the game. They were able to do it in the second half against Bethune-Cookman. You see Adams, the injured player. So that's a big loss there for the Alabama State defense. What a warrior he has been today. But without question, you know, a chance for Alabama State's offense at home and Demetrius Davis to get things done. They still have all three of their timeouts. So, you know, that's a big thing too. But, you know, this is a big conversion here. If they don't get this conversion, you only need a field goal. And John Jaden, even though you're kicking into the win, he's had a decent season so far. So we'll see what happens here.
Well, this play may decide if that's a game winner or a game tire, right, as they'll go for two. They move the ball to the far hash mark. They got two guys outside the hash mark on this side on this two-point try. And for the first time today, Musa under center. He's going to roll it back, throw it to the other side. Almost tipped. They throw it to a lineman. He doesn't get in.
Well, one of our linemen was being held. I think that was 94 Jordan. He was being held. They didn't call it. And luckily, the lineman didn't get in the end zone. So, with 4:20 left, you're only down by one. You only need a field goal to win it. So Alabama State, you know, they hadn't done much offensively, but look at where they were. You know, we talked about it before the game. Can they get to the fourth quarter? They did that. Can they make a big play? They took the lead early on that block punt. Now they've got an opportunity, even though it's with the offense, to win the football game, and that's the key. They had to get this game a fourth quarter. I thought this would be a fourth quarter game. It is a fourth quarter game, and we have a chance to win it here with our offense.
I think I mentioned it. I don't know if it's going to pay off, but Florida A&M used two timeouts in the third quarter. They have one left. By the way, that was 51 who caught the pass, Kamari Thompson. And I'm going to guess that's his first catch of the year. I don't have their season stats in front of me, but
I would say that's a pretty safe bet on that one. But I think now Florida A&M was 0-for-4 on two-point attempts this year. I was looking early on, so.
Well, that one was an automatic. You know you got to go for two there to make it a field goal because kick the extra point, it really doesn't do you good at this point of the game. So what kind of a return can we get here for ASU?
Going back to what I said earlier about, you know, Alabama State going for two right there. Well, let's say you don't get it down there. You're only within one score. So, really, at that point, it didn't make much of a difference. And now you stop them on that two-point conversion. So, see if we can get a big return here and give us a shorter field to work with.
Dunn is in between McMinn. And I believe the other one is Scott. And it's going into the end zone. And they're going to bring it out. Dunn. And that was not a wise decision. He's cut down to the 10-yard line. Should have put the knee down. I know he's had some success.
That's when he was thinking, I got to make a play for my teammates.
Let's see who comes out at quarterback.
It's Crawley.
It is going to be Crawley. Now, did they call a fair catch?
They call a fair catch. You get it up at the 20, 25, I believe. You do. Oh, it's offside.
Oh, how about that? Thank you very much.
Wow.
Talk about a break for ASU.
You're not kidding.
So not only do you not have it at the 10, you're going to get another chance to return it. And I have a feeling that Eddie Robinson went over to his three guys back there and said, if it's in the end zone, let it go. There's plenty of time here. 4:15 to go.
Well, don't they reset the clock now? It was at 4:20. When they reset
no,
the
I don't think it's
like
a
that?
Since the clock moved, it was not a dead ball penalty, so it's not going to reset the clock.
Well, like I said, Graham, you got the game where you want it. Now, offense hasn't played very well today. But listen, if you put together one good drive, you can put yourself in second place in the SWAC East. So we'll see what happens here on this next kickoff.
Martinez this time will kick from the 30. The receivers are all back on the 10 this time. And I have a feeling they were told if it goes over your head, let it go. He is from the goal line this time. A little bit of a seam, and he'll get to the 20. Much better than the 10, I'll give you that. So that's where ASU will have it with 4:08 to go. A touchdown will win it, more than likely.
So they picked up about 8 yards on that swing of momentum. So you kind of see that you got a 5-yard penalty. You get 8 extra yards. So it kind of evened out for you. So
well, you don't feel crowded,
right,
for one thing.
You don't feel in the shadow of your end zone. And now you got to go, you know, 80 yards for a touchdown, about 65, about, you know, maybe 50, 55 yards for a potential field goal. So,
and Miles Crowley is in the game, the sophomore quarterback, 6'4", 200 pounds. And he'll throw one in the flat, complete. Johnson skips a tackle and gets about 5 yards. He gets out of bounds. Actually, he'll give him about 7 on the play to the 27-yard line.
So Now with Crowley in the game, you don't have that dynamic of, you know, maneuvering in the pocket, but he has the arm strength to get the job done. So, and he's played a lot. So you still feel comfortable with Crowley in the game. You just don't have that run pass option like you did when you have Davis in the game.
Second and three. No time to run. No reason to rush, I should say. Handoff. We hadn't called Howell's name all day, and I believe that is his carry. And he might have pushed ahead. Well, he won't get enough for the first down, but he'll be about a yard short. 3:27 and counting. A&M with a touchdown to take the lead, 15-14. They missed the two-point try. But you got to get a third down here. They actually move him back to the 28 on the mark. There goes Howell, and he's got the first down and more across the 35 to the 37. Now, Howell's fresh. He has not played.
Yeah, he's kind of a close. They run the three guys. They go to the hot hand, kind of like the closer, like the Mariano Rivera type of thing at the end of the game. But Howell's got the fresh legs.
Here he goes again, but he can't break out of the tackle of the defensive lineman. I believe that's Minter.
They're eventually going to have to go with the fake here and try to go over the middle or go deep down the sideline here, take a shot downfield.
Well, you don't want to take too much time. Right. You're down to 2.5.
Now, remember, you only need a field goal here, so, you know, still in that window, but you're going into the wind as well, so you want to get down as far as you possibly can to set up a potential game-winning field goal.
Second and seven. Howell, this time caught in the backfield. He's going to lose 2 yards. They brought the run blitz, and it worked.
Well, now, you know, I don't think Harry Williams wanted to put the game in Crowley's hands, but he's going to have to on this third down and 10. But again, you know, it's a guy that's played a lot, got a lot of confidence in his arm, so we'll see if he can make this third down. It's ticking away, though.
Reset the play.
They got to get going. This is like A&M in the first half.
They're under 10 seconds on the play clock. Crowley still hadn't gotten the snap. Now he does. Looking.
The ball knocked
out of his hand by his own player. I think a lineman hit it. It is recovered by the Hornets. Ooh. Now you got to take a timeout, I think.
Well, I don't know what. This is, I got to tell you.
You got fourth and about 15.
Well, I guess they feel like, and again, you have all three of your timeouts. I'm not sure what's going on. Did they know that they're down by a point? I'm not sure. They're acting like this game
they're
is
ahead.
Tied.
Yeah.
Or they're ahead. They're down by a point.
And now A&M calls timeout.
I'll tell you what. When they look back at this moment, that's unbelievable. They let the drive started with about 4 minutes left in the game. Now it's fourth down anyway. But look at the situation now. You had your three timeouts. If you would, maybe you're saying, "Well, we'll save it for later." But you know, I'm not sure about that.
What's the old saying? You can't take them home with you.
Can't take them home, but my goodness.
Yeah, I don't know what was going on there.
I don't think even, and I don't think Florida A&M was like, well, Florida A&M was kind of like, well, what's going on? That's logistical issues there late in the game. But you know, Florida A&M had the same problem in the first half. They kind of loafed around there at the end of the first half. But I tell you, I'm not sure if Eddie Rob. I'm not sure if anybody. I'm not sure they know they're down by a point or not. Not saying they don't know that. But
well, I think they do. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and assume that, but I would say that
there.
I don't know. I really wonder if they knew what play they wanted to run. I think that was the problem. And they got bailed out by the timeout by the Rattlers. Well, they still got to get up to the 47. The ball's at the 29. Either that or get an interference or some type of call against Florida A&M. Looking to throw. The ball popped up again. It ends up in a lineman's hands, and he's going to go down. That's going to be a fumble recovery for one of the offensive linemen, Trayvon Taylor, but the ball will go over on downs.
Well, the good news is you still have all three of your timeouts left, so Florida A&M can't run the clock out unless they get a first down. So they still had to get a first down to win the football game. But tell you, there's going to be a lot of questioning about that clock management there at the end of the game.
So they're celebrating across the way. You're right. I mean, ASU has three timeouts left, and they'll use all three of them here. It is still just a one-point game. Stranger things have happened. Even if they kick a field goal.
Even if you kick a field goal, you still within
you got a chance.
Yeah, you got a shot. So see what happens here.
Their offensive coordinator is Joseph Henry. He's out on the field, and he is yelling and screaming.
So you expect
they're going to get in victory formation.
Well, you expect them to kind of take a few seconds. You got to call a timeout here.
I think they did, and the clock's still running.
The clock is still moving. I don't believe. I don't know.
Yeah, I saw that there was a.
Yeah.
This line judge tried to stop the clock. They're going to put this back on about 10 seconds.
Wow, my goodness.
So they're going to reset the clock. So they put it on 37 seconds.
I mean, you got to call that timeout immediately.
Well, and I think they did. That was just it. I saw the official stop the clock. But it didn't stop.
It was a malfunction at somebody's junction then. But listen, this Alabama State defense really played well, played valiantly. And, you know, the offense just didn't do enough today. But listen, you know, there's still outside opportunity here. Win probability probably at the 99.998% for Florida A&M, but Alabama State, they'll look back at this game and see the opportunities that they missed, and we'll see.
And now they're going to line up and try to run a play because they realize ASU has their, and they're going to throw the football. Oh, my goodness.
Well, I'll tell you
that's going to stop the clock.
Well, that helps Alabama State.
Did these guys read the manual?
Well, I think Willie Simmons and Robinson got together before the game and hashed this thing out. No,
and I don't know that you want to try to kick a field goal because you've already had one putt blocked.
But I think what they wanted him to do is kind of take, you know, held the ball a little bit and run a little bit of time off the clock. He just took the ball and chucked it out of bounds. Now, they could have called grounding on that play, but on something like that, you could call grounding, but.
Let's see what they do here. Third and about 13.
Oh, boy. It's a Keystone Cops here late in the game.
ASU brings everybody. They're going to stop the running back, which I believe is McLeod. And they'll stop the clock again. 29 seconds. It ain't much time.
It's not much time, but they have a timeout. So even, you know, let's say you make the kick. They're going to get the ball with maybe, you know, 20, you make the kick. They'll get the ball about, you know, 15 seconds left. They make one big play down the field. They call a timeout. You put yourself in position, at least to put yourself in the end zone. And otherwise, it could be a potential game winner here.
I don't think they're going to kick it. I'd be shocked if they try here because you don't want to risk a block. If you don't make a first down or you don't make a touchdown, ASU's still got a long way to go to score. I know you and I, we've seen some doozies over the years as far as how a game ends. This one's kind of setting up for that, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of those games where, you know, one of those finishes where everybody's going to be going back and working on situations the next week of practice. I mean, this is, you know, in the first half, Florida A&M had issues, you know, trying to get the right play with the clock. And Alabama State, kind of the same thing here. Kind of same thing with their drive, you know. You like to see them have a little sense of urgency. And obviously, they went backward on their drive, so that kind of hurt that a little bit. But, boy, you like to see them, you know, not take so much time off the clock. They took almost 3 minutes off the clock. And, you know, you only have three, you have three timeouts. But time is really more important in that situation than the timeouts.
They are going to run a play.
They're going to run a play here.
So, Musa's back.
Yeah, they don't
on fourth, and they got to get to the 10-yard line. Fourth and 13 from the ASU 23. That's a pitch that's going to count as a pass. Colton Adams runs him down for a yard loss. And 24 seconds left. Here comes Flags.
Uh-oh.
What do we got here?
Now, this is against Florida A&M. That's going to give Alabama State the ball near the 40-yard line.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
What was I just saying? I tell you what. You got about a couple plays. You get down here close enough, you're going to give Jaden a chance to win this football game.
That was incredible. That's going to put the ball right around the 40-yard line. You don't have much time. 24 seconds.
But you got about – you can get it.
They just gave you a first down.
You can get about two or three plays here. I mean, you get some plays here, even if you get over the middle. It, as long as it's a first down, a clock stops to move the chains. So, and you have one timeout left, too, so you can stop the clock with the timeout.
You
a lot
gotta,
of options here, but you got to move the ball down the field.
You've got to get the ball inside the 30-yard line. Here's a snap. Crowley running.
Can't take a sack.
Looking to throw. It is caught out of bounds.
Yeah. Great job there on the sideline.
18 seconds left.
Courtney Cox pushed out the receiver there on the sideline. Great job there. That's exactly what you wanted.
But that would have been a great play because it would have put ASU on the Florida A&M side of the 50-yard line. Can they do that again? It did stop the clock. That's the good news.
Perhaps we try a double move here. Maybe try to catch somebody off guard here.
How about a hook and lateral? They're only rushing three. Down the field. Caught. He got a foot in. It's caught. It should be first down.
Well, we're going to find out.
And they're going to mark him at the 46-yard line, 44 first down.
You got to spike it.
It's a. The clock should be stopped. It was out of bounds.
They don't have to spike it. If it was out of bounds, they don't have to spike it.
Holy cow. Now what do we got? Somebody's stopping the clock.
Well, I think they're going to look at it.
He got a foot in. I don't have any doubt unless he was juggling the football as he went out of bounds.
Well, there was an injured play for Florida A&M as well. So we got a lot of stuff going on here.
So that's what they stopped it for.
They stopped it for the injured player. Okay. So, Graham, I tell you what, you get a good 10, 15-yard play here, and you're going to give John Jaden a chance to win this football game when it looked like the probability was less than zero.
Well, they got to get about 20 more yards. There's 13 seconds left.
And the wind has died. Well, the wind was dying down just a little bit. Got to kick it at the right time.
You can throw it to the middle of the field because you've got a timeout.
Got a timeout.
Low snap. Crawley picks it up.
Can't
He's running.
Sack.
He's got a man in the sideline. It's overthrown. And now you're basically down to one play. If you can throw it to the middle of the field and get the clock stopped, you might have a chance. You cannot kick one from here, though. Not with the wind.
Either.
And we got – do we have a flag?
I'm not sure.
The officials are congregating. Apparently not.
Coaches out on the field. Coaches all the way out on the field. Well, you either got one play to the end zone or maybe get one quick out and – give Jaden a chance with a long field goal. You know, you still have that one timeout, so you can still work the middle of the field. But you got to tell, you know, as a receiver, your instinct is to keep running. Well, you got to get down in this situation.
In this case, you got to get back to the football.
Or
it's second down, but that doesn't matter. They throw it over the middle, and it's caught.
Timeout.
Timeout. The ball is at, they're going to mark him where? At the 35.
Two seconds
left.
And give him a shot.
This is going to be a tough field goal.
It's going to be tough.
But John Jaden won't have to buy a drink for a year if he can make this one.
Boy, I tell you what, Graham, they put themselves in position. The personal foul penalty there for Florida A&M, and you give John Jaden a chance. And boy, I tell you what, this place is going to erupt. The Alabama State side of this place is going to erupt if Jaden can knock this thing through.
Jaden hit one 49 yards a couple of weeks ago in Birmingham, but he did not have a breeze in his face.
He's going to have to put everything.
Well, that's just it. You don't overkick. That's the one thing you don't do.
He's going to have to put a lot into this one. It's a pressure-packed situation for this young man.
I mean, he's just a freshman, for crying out loud. What's the big deal?
Well, you know, sometimes when you're a freshman, you don't know you don't know the enormity of the situation. So we'll see the ticker of this young man is where it is. It's going to be a
52-yarder.
Oh, boy.
Grace will kneel down at the 42. That wind has been picking up steadily here in the latter portion of this one.
Trying to wait it out, trying to see if they can get that breeze to die down a second.
Players are telling the fans to calm down. We got to hear the snap count.
I don't think they can right now.
Here we go. For the game, for the win.
No timeouts either way.
52-yard attempt. John Jaden, the freshman. Good snap. Kick is blocked.
Wow.
This may turn into a 7-point win on the blocked field goal. And that's how this one's going to end. Well, it was going to be a tough kick either way.
Yeah, and he had to kick it low. And when you have to kick it low, unfortunately, those are the type of things that happen when you have to kick it low. A valiant effort, a valiant finish by Alabama State. They gave themselves a chance at the end. But Florida A&M just came up with just one more play there at the end. But you gave yourself a chance to win. And for Alabama State, I think you played Jackson State very tough. You played Florida A&M. You had the lead in the fourth quarter. I think there's a lot to build on in both of those, even with you losing those games. There's a lot to build on with those two losses because this game could easily swing back in favor of Alabama State. So I think there's a lot to look forward to for Alabama State. And I think for Coach Robinson going in that Turkey Day Classic, I think he's got to feel very good about the effort of his team as the game went along. But you need a lot more from the offense.
This will go into the books as a 21-14 win for Florida A&M. They did return it, obviously, there for the touchdown. They will not kick the extra point. What a crazy, crazy ending. And it wasn't just that missed field goal or blocked field goal. There were a lot of things going on in those last couple of minutes that I'm sure there's going to be some discussions regarding clock management, and we'll see how that plays out. And I'm looking at my producer. We need to keep going here for a minute. But back to what I was saying, this game comes down to how you play the clock.
Yeah, for both teams, it came down to how to play the clock, and fortunately, it didn't go Alabama State's way.
All right. Well, that's going to do it from ASU Stadium, your final is 21-14. Florida A&M beats Alabama State. We appreciate everybody watching. Again, the final game of the year coming up Thanksgiving Day as the Hornets will finish up against Arkansas Pine Bluff Turkey Day Classic, 2 o'clock start. For everybody here in the booth, we appreciate it. We'll talk to you soon. Good night from ASU Stadium.
You had to rush and leave yourself a half a minute.